All right. Thanks, Amelia. And hello and good morning from my side. My name is Martin Leyenseder, and I will present to you now something about single pair Ethernet, or more exactly, the single pair Ethernet filter design. Just for your information, at the moment I'm sitting in front of a laptop, so I don't have a second screen here. This means it can happen that maybe I'm clicking on and showing you some information I already said. So this by accident, just for your information. So what I want to talk with you today is first the introduction about single pair Ethernet filtering. So what is single pair Ethernet? How the filtering is working also for other reference designs. I like to talk with you about current reference designs because there are some on the market from IC houses. And what is shown in the data sheets of these IC houses? And when I talk about that, I also talk about the isolation of the filtering. And therefore, you will see that we have a special solution for isolation. We not do the isolation with the capacitors. Instead, we do isolation with transformers. And for that, I will do some comparison measurements, and I will show you different solutions. Solutions for 10 base T1 and solutions for 100 base T1. Last but not least, we have the topic power over data line. And also here I want to show you how power over data line, how the filtering is working for single pair Ethernet. So when we talk about single pair Ethernet, then we not talk about the Ethernet that you all have in your offices or at home. No, I more talk about the Ethernet that is seen in big factory halls, like you can see it in the picture here. We have different devices, we have robots, we have sensors, we have actuators, cameras, and all of these devices in the past worked separately. So the data was not exchanged. But now this is more and more changing. Everything is combined, compared now, everything is combined. So this means that if you're sitting into your office, you really can see what maybe the camera of a machine is doing, if some sensor is defect, if something needs to be repaired. And all of this is only possible because all the data is connected. So when we look inside a machine, then nowadays we see something like that. We see different kinds of cables and connectors inside. We see LAN connectors, so the RJ45. We see RS232 connectors for other bus systems. We see M12 connectors. And this is because different bus systems are working, especially on the field level. And the single pair Ethernet should be a solution for that, because if you have a communication on the field level with device, net hard, and the others, you always need to translate the information. You always need some kind of a gateway to transfer the data for Ethernet so that you can bring the data into the cloud. And with single pair Ethernet, it should be possible that from the cloud to the fields, to the single sensor, there's one communication protocol for everything. And that makes it much simpler and, of course, much faster. Right before I started the presentation, I was thinking, maybe I should explain you what is single pair Ethernet at all, because maybe not every one of you knows what is single pair Ethernet. So single pair Ethernet, at the beginning, we had since 30 years, we had the standard Ethernet, so to say. It started with 10 base T1 or with 10 base T. This means 10 megabit per second of data can be exchanged. And this was exchanged with a cable, and the cable has four wires. And we have two wires for transmitting the data, and we have two wires for receiving the data. This is with 10 base T, and this is also with the fast internet 100 base T. Later on, Gigabit Ethernet was developed, and with Gigabit Ethernet, different things changed, and also the cables or the wires inside the cable changed. Now we not have a transmit and a receive channel anymore. Instead, we use all four pairs, so it means eight wires that we are using, and every pair of wire is transmission and receive channel at the same time. And with that, and also some other tricks, we can increase the speed of the Ethernet from 100 megabit to 1 gigabit or even to 10 gigabit per second. And what single pair Ethernet is doing is that it's reducing again the four pairs to one pair, but it's keeping its bidirectional communication. And so we have much thinner wires, much thinner cables, which has of course an advantage in case of weight or cost, like you will see later. Single pair Ethernet is coming with two single wires. In the automotive industry, single pair Ethernet is also used. Here the cables mostly are 15 meters long, and they are unshielded. Unshielded because of weight reduction, and 50 meters is not a very big distance, but in the industry we say the cable should be always shielded, especially as in the industry the cable reach is longer. We have 40 meters with 100 base T1. This is in the IEEE 802.3BW. We have 40 meters also in the IEEE 802.3BP. This is for 1000 base T1. And this is the very special thing, even up to 1000 meters or more with 10 base T1. And especially this 10 base T1 in the IEEE 802.3CG makes the single pair Ethernet very, very interesting for the industry, because we can really go from the cloud to the field level. We can come over very big distances. So this is very interesting. The normal Ethernet, the standard Ethernet, by the way, has a cable reach of 100 meters. In the standard Ethernet, there is something called power over Ethernet. This means if you have a device like a camera or actuator, you can supply these devices with energy. And this is called the power over Ethernet. So over the same cable, like the data is going, also the power is going. And the same thing that we have for power over Ethernet, we also have for power for the single pair Ethernet. This is called the power over data line, also called poodle. And over two wires, you can supply 50 watt of power. So for the standard single pair Ethernet, there are some hybrid versions, and here even 200 watts are possible. So what is the advantage in using single pair Ethernet? I already told you some advantages, but I want to go a bit deeper into detail here. To compare single pair Ethernet, I like to compare it with the bus system that is most common in the industry nowadays, and this is the standard Ethernet. And here I have three pictures, and I go from the left to the right, and you can see on the left side the size of the connector. Yeah, when you see on the left side a single pair Ethernet connector compared to the RJ45 connector, then the size difference is quite big. Yeah, the single pair Ethernet connector is very small, and it's also robust, like you can see it in the middle. This picture shows the connection between the plug and the connector. When I go to the next slide, it's maybe more clearly. So this is a cut through the connector and the plug. And you can see that, like with an M12 connector, the connection is really, yeah, so the plug connection is really surrounded by the connector. So no matter how you pull the cable in each direction, you always will have a contact with plug and connector. On the other side, we have RJ45. And you know, I'm a product manager for RJ45, and we know that the connection between plug and connector is not that bad. Yeah, it's really stable, more stable than people think, but it's only a point-to-point connection, like you can see in the picture. Yeah, we have this this contact spring at the RJ45 connector, and if I insert a plug, we have only a contact, a very thin contact to one point, Like I said, the connection is quite stable. So even if you pull the cable here, not too much, then the connection should be stable. But of course, it's nothing compared to the single pair Ethernet connector. Then the connection is also simple. And what I mean is, we only have one channel left, and this makes it easier for the connection on the PCB. So we have, in our case now, only one transformer, only one capacitor, and so on. In case with the standard Ethernet, we have four channels with the gigabit or 10 gigabit. And then everything is, of course, more complex and also needs more space on the PCB. Further advantages for single pair Ethernet. Yeah, so the diameter of the cable is reduced on 30%. And with the diameter of the cable, of course, also the needed copper is reduced. And so the weight is reduced on 50%. This is quite a lot. Another advantage is, of course, if the cable is much thinner, it's better if you think on small robots, yeah, where you have to route the cable through the machine. Then it's of course better if the cable is thinner, because then the cable radius, if you bend it, can be smaller. Then we have the power over data line, the portal with 50 watt in the IP20 connector version. This of course is not better than with the standard Ethernet, except the hybrid version. This is really better, but if you think about other bus systems where it's not possible at all to provide some energy, this is really, really an advantage. And of course, the combination of long cable reach and high speed, this is a big advantage. If you see on the picture on the right side, here I listed different field buses, Profibus, DeviceNet, Hard, and so on. And we can see that single pair Ethernet has the fastest speed and the largest cable reach. So this is really, really nice. And we have, like I said before, a communication from the sensor to the cloud in one system. What I want to explain you with this slide is that every bus system needs some filtering. And with filtering, I mean what comes between the connector and the chip. The chip, this is a PHY chip. This is transferring the voltage and current signals into data. And in between this chip and the connector, we need a filtering. In this case, I'm showing Profibus. You can also see here is some more information about Profibus if you follow the link on the right-hand corner. In this case, we have a common mode choke inside. This is for filtering of the common mode signals. We have TVS diodes inside, also different capacitors, and also some P filter on the power lanes. So this is what we have for Profibus. We also have the same thing for Ethernet. This is a PCB that we built for the standard Ethernet. And there you can see the MDI, this is the connector and the passive components, the filtering. On top, you can see the power supply. This is to supply the PHY chip with power and the PHY chip with its resistors and pull-up resistors and so on. This is here in the middle. And when I talk about the MDI, then this is what we can see. We have the connector on the left side, and in the middle, this is the filtering. In this case, this is a gigabit Ethernet. We have four transformers, four LAN transformers, four common mode chokes, and TVS diodes as well. And this is how a PCB is looking like for single pair Ethernet. Actually, this PCB is what we built up in our laboratory with some new 10BASE-T1 PHY chip. And like what you could see with the standard Ethernet, we can also see with the single pair Ethernet. So here we again have the MDI, the PHY chip, what you didn't see at the standard Ethernet was the MCU, the microcontroller. So of course this is this needs to be added. Also at the circuit board before, here it's shown. The file chip has also a power supply and something like RxTX mixing. This RxTX mixing is against signal collision because you only have two lanes. Everything is trans the two wires. This is transmission and receive at the same time, and that there's no signal collision. We have this RxTX mixing. This is some resistors network, and here this is how the filtering can look like for single pair Ethernet. Yeah, on the left side again the standard Ethernet, and on top the single pair Ethernet, and on the right side the Ethernet, the single pair Ethernet with its transformer, CAN mode choke, and the TVS diode and different capacitors. Of course, this is only a marketing picture. Yeah, if you see then the capacitor here, this is normally you would not route such a you would not do such a rectangle routing. This would be not so good for the signals. But okay, I go more into detail later with the how this could be look like. You can be excited. So, what is the single pair Ethernet filtering? This is the big question now. And when I talk about a single pair Ethernet filtering, I need to go to what is written in the file chip data sheets, because this is where normally the engineers took the information from. And what we can see in the data sheets is something like that. So this is the filtering of 100 base T1 dual or single PHY for automotive Ethernet. And so for that you have your automotive connector on the right hand side, your PHY chip is on the left side, and in between this is the filtering. And what you have here, this is a CAN mode choke. It should be 200 microhenry, so it needs to be it needs to have a high inductance for very broadband filtering. Then we have here, this is a CAN mode termination, so it's also some termination to a ground, and it has also some kind of ESD filtering function. And then we have some isolation capacitors, and these capacitors, they come with 100 nanofarad. And normally with automotive Ethernet with 50 volts. And these 50 volts and 100 nanofarad capacitors are okay for automobiles, because inside the automobile, you have some closed system. So it's not possible for the user normally to touch into the system or to go into this. So this is fine. But when we talk about industrial use, then we have a special case here. And this is that when we have a look at the IEEE 802.3 CG, this is the norm for 10 base T1. Then we have a safety norm link to the IEC 6950-1, or the new norm is the 62368-1. And this says that you need 1.5 kV of isolation for 1 minute. So this brings us to the situation that we need to think about what we do with this isolation here. Do we need to improve it, and how we can improve this? And this is what we did. So what we did is that we did some experiments, and this is that we took different filters and used it for 10 base T1. And we also did this for 100 base T1 and for gigabit speed. And at the beginning we thought about having one filter for everything. So one filter that is valid for 10 base T1 signals and 100 base T1 signals and 1000 base T1 signals. But we figured out that this is not possible, like I will show you later. So we started with the 10 base T1 case. And here, this is what we can find when we have a look at the IEEE 802.3 CG. So this is the communication norm for 10BASE-T1 single pair Ethernet. And if we have a look at the MDI requirements, so these are the requirements, like I said, from the connector and the filtering, then we can see this here. This is the return loss that we need to fulfill. And out of the norm, we have the mode conversion loss. Yeah, the return loss, so these are the signals that coming back with reflection when we have a signal, and the mode conversion loss is a differential mode signal that turns into a come mode signal inside your circuit. And what we and this is quite similar to the standard Ethernet. So also with in standard Ethernet, we have to deal with return loss, insertion loss, come mode rejection. So we know how to handle it. But for 10BASE-T1, this is what I still wanted to explain to you. The mode conversion loss in the norm should be, I think, minus 25 dB from 200 kilohertz to 10 megahertz. But some engineer of a company told me that the norm is not realistic so much here. So it better should be a mode conversion loss of minus 45 dB at least to reach a good communication over 1,000 meters. So, and this is already complicated a bit, but what is more complicated, this is the deep frequencies, 100 kilohertz to 1 megahertz for 10BASE-T1. This is really a challenge for us, because with these deep frequencies, it's very hard to meet the limits of the IEEE, as you can see in the next slides. So what we did is that we try to find some solutions. On the left side, you can see what we did with the 50 volt capacitors. So we used 50 volt capacitors. So this is originally the schematic out of the file chip data sheet. And here these tiny capacitors, these are the 50 volt isolation capacitors. And now this is what I said before with the deep frequencies. To have a sufficient reduction of the mode conversion loss and also for the return loss, we need a very, very large come mode choke. Yeah? The inductance of the come mode choke needs to be very big, very high, that we can reach the lower frequencies. And so this is the big dominant element here. In the middle, we did basically the same thing, except that we changed the capacitors. So here we took also 100 nanofarad capacitors, but these capacitors can handle 2000 volt of isolation. Yeah, so as you can see, this gets very big. These capacitors are so big, they are even not available in our company, so we purchased them from, I don't know, DigiKey Mauser, so that we can make some experiments here. And on the right side, we did the same thing, but we did it with a transformer. So why we did it with a transformer? The reason is that the signals for 10BASE-T1, they go from 100 kilohertz to 20 megahertz. And this is quite similar to the signal of 100BASE-T for the standard Ethernet. Also here, we are using the transformers, and this is working fine. Yeah? And the interesting thing is that one transformer has a middle pin. And the middle pin function is that it can really lead common mode signals to ground. Yeah, so it's not filtering common mode signals. Instead, it's more making some kind of a path to ground for the common mode signals, so that the phi on the other side is saved. And this effect is very good in deep frequencies, so that we even not need a common mode choke at all for this filtering. So you can see the transformer and a connection to ground, and you can see a TVS diode, and that's it. We also have a capacitor C3, and this is needed to reach the deep frequencies, like I can show you later. But this is now the result that we gained from the measurements. So now we have the return loss again, and this big line here, this here, in black, this is the return loss limit out of the IEEE. And the black and the gray lines, this is what we measured with the capacitors. So this is the 2 kV capacitor solution. The gray one with 50 volt and the 2 kV solution is a black line. And here with the transformer, we have better results, especially in the deeper frequencies. If we zoom a bit closer here, then you can see that we are very, very close to the limit of the IEEE. And so it's maybe too narrow, even if we think about tolerances of parts. So we maybe cannot guarantee with 100% of the parts that the limits of the IEEE can be reached at all times. Instead, with a transformer, we have a very, very good, or we have a better performance here, and we have some distance between the IEEE and the limits, the IEEE limits, and what we have measured with our transformer. With the mode conversion loss, the picture is different. So again, we have here the limit of the IEEE, and you can see that the transformer solutions solution and the capacitor solutions, they have quite a big distance between the limits and the measurements. So at least it's 30 dB difference. Here, there is the advantage on the capacitor side. So up to, let's say, 6 megahertz, the capacitor solution has its advantage. After that, then the transformer solution is better. Here, before I said the limit should be more or less minus 45 dB. But even if you say the limit is minus 45, you can see that we quite have some distance between the limit and the measured values. So this is, again, the schematic, the circuit for the transformer. And I will explain you a bit into detail what I mean with this. So first of all, we have here the transformer, and the transformer is connected to ground on both sides. The R1 and C1, this is known from the standard Ethernet. So this is a connector, this is a resistor for termination, and this is a 2 kV capacitor for measurements of high port to the ground. C2 is a capacitor. It's needed because the PHY chip cannot send negative voltage signals. So normally the voltage coming out from a PHY chip is plus minus 2 volts, but it's the PHY chip is generating some kind of offset. And so that we won't have a current from the communication lines to ground. We need to have some kind of a blocking capacitor here, and this is C2. And C3, this is something special. This is C3 is what we need for 10 base T1, because without C3 we cannot reach such a good performance in deep frequencies. So this resistor, this capacitor, helps us to improve the signal in frequencies above 35 kilohertz. Sometimes the TVS diode, I want to explain still. Here the TVS diode is right between the transformer and the PHY chip. Normally you would say, why not do the TVS diode close to the connector? Because normally ESD events come from the cable, and they should be put to ground or filtered as soon as possible. Yes, you can do the TVS diode close to the connector, but you need to consider one thing. If you do hypo testing and you do hypo test from the cable to the ground, then you should somehow switch off the TVS diode. Else the current fully will go through the TVS diode to ground, and so it can happen that your TVS diode gets damaged from the hypo test. If you cannot remove the TVS diode before you do the hypo test, then you better put it between the transformer and the PHY chip. Capacitor C3 is what I still want to talk about. Like I said, it's needed for deeper frequencies. Some transformers, they don't have the possibility that you can split the middle pin. And what you also can do is that you that instead of taking one capacitor, you take two with the same value, and you place it like that. I show you in the picture on the right side. Yeah. So this is also working. The performance is quite the same. Then when we did these measurements and everything, then we were quite happy about that. And proudly, we went to IC houses and showed our solution here. And at the beginning, the IC houses also said, this is a very good solution, very nice. But later on, they came with some request to us. And this was that they said, wait a second, we have a problem here. And this is when we look at the IEEE 802.3, there's a chapter from the file chip requirements. And this chapter, this is saying something about transmitter output droop. And this output droop, this is when you set your file chip into a test mode 2, and then you measure the signal, then the droop should be less than 10% of the signal. And what is meant with this, you can see on the right hand side. This was quite a problem for us to help these IC houses with their request, because to measure this, we actually needed to program a file chip. So they sent us a lot of file chips, and we built up a circuit board and did the measurements, or we set the file chip into the test mode, and then we measured on our oscilloscope what is the result here. And you can see here, we need to measure, so this is the signal coming out from the file chip, and 133 nanoseconds after the peak, we have to measure with a point, and I think 800 nanoseconds after, we also have to measure, and the droop of this signal should not be more than 10%. And this at first was a problem with our parts, because we calculated our losses and we had minus 10.3%. So actually we were out of the specifications of the norm. And so we did some further research and tried to make some improvements. And the good thing was, sorry, that the solution was quite simple. We only had to increase the capacitance of the capacitors. Now here, before we had 100 nanofarad, and so we increased that to 470 nanofarad. And with that, we had a droop of under 6%, and everything was good again. This is now how the schematic is looking like if you build this up. So if you ever have seen the single pair Ethernet connector, yeah, you have also seen this from some slides before, then you see the filtering here, this is quite little here. Yeah, the transformer, this is some SMT component. It's something like a combo choke, yeah, but with more pins. So you can place it, you can make pick and placing and SMT soldering. And so this component is maybe 4.5 millimeters long. Another larger component is the capacitor with 2 kV, but the rest of the filters is quite small. Yeah, and this is the capacitors with 470 nanofarad. Now, what is happening with 100 base T1? Here we have other challenges. The challenge is not the return loss anymore or the deep frequencies. This is working because everything what is more than 1 megahertz is not a problem. But here the mode conversion loss, this is a bit the challenge, because it's minus 50 dB. I think maybe the line has moved a bit in my presentation. So I think it's minus 50 dB that we need to reach up to 20 megahertz. So we did the same thing like we did before. We built it up the circuit. Here you can see what is the advantage of this automotive Ethernet and the capacitors here. Every component is very small. Yeah. So the cost, of course, of this filtering is very low. Yeah. In the middle, the same thing, but with the 2 kV capacitors. And you can see here everything gets smaller except the capacitors, they still stay large, but we can, instead of the big Hummel choke before, we can take a very small one. And then we have our circuit with the transformer. In difference to before, this time we need a cam mode choke because this effect with the cam mode and the transformer, where the transformer is leading cam mode signals to the ground, this is not working over the full frequency. So we need the support of the cam mode choke for higher frequencies, and this is this here. And we not need the capacitive C3 anymore for our deep frequencies. And these are the results that measured. So here we can see close together, these are the capacitor solutions. Here we see that the capacitor solutions have an advantage at frequencies up to, let's say, 20 megahertz. Over 20 megahertz, the return loss of the transformer and the capacitors, yeah, the transformer is quite in the middle of the two capacitor solutions. The best solution, this is with 2 kV capacitors. With the mode conversion loss, it's looking like that. So at the lower frequencies, everything seems to be all right. But at higher frequencies, there's also something very critical. And this is when we have a zoom closer here, then the 50 volt capacitor solution is very, very close to the norm limit, while the 2 kV capacitor solution has a bit of better distance, and the transformer solution has the best performance. You can improve this by using larger cam mode choke. So if you use a bigger cam mode choke, then all the signals, no matter if it's a transformer or a cam mode choke or a capacitor, will go a bit lower. So this really can improve your signal. Yeah, but in our test, we compared with the same cam mode chokes. This is now the footprint of all the three solutions for 100 base team. One, again, you can see this is the advantage of the 50 volt capacitor solution. This is very small, especially with the capacitors here. But also quite small is the transformer solution. And the biggest one is the 2 kV capacitor solution. So depending on how much space you need to have and what kind of application you have, you need to choose what is the right solution for you. Now I come to the chapter power over data line. And this is also some very interesting thing. To explain you power over data line, I like to introduce the power over Ethernet at first. So this is some schematic some picture where I explain power over Ethernet. You have a powered power source, and you have a powered device. I click now to the next slide if there's more information here. No. Okay. So of course the power source is not like this connector here. So it's more like that you have some power inside, and then you have a AC-DC converter to get 48 volts and up to 1 ampere of current. But then you have some mixing of data, in this case coming from a laptop, and the data and the signals over the same cable go over the cable from the power source to the powered device. And there, data and power are splitted again to supply, for example, a camera with energy. With power over Ethernet, it's looking like that. On the right side, you have the cable. On the left side, you have the chip. And the signals, they go from the connector over the transformer to the chip and back. Yeah, so in this case, it's a 100 base T chip. So we have a transmission channel and a receive channel. The signals, this is changing current. So this is going over the transformer. The power for power over Ethernet is different. This is a constant current. And so the transformer will block this current. Instead, this current is going through the middle pin two extra pins here to supply, in this case, this camera. With power over data line, this is a bit different. Here, this picture, this is what we did with a simulation with LTSpice. So you can imagine maybe on the left side, so this is a power source, yeah. On the left side, this is a PHY chip. On the right side, this is the powered device, and here also is a PHY chip. And the data, sorry. And then we have here the power source and the powered device. The power that you need to supply the camera is going from the power source to the powered device, but it's not going over the transformer. While the signals are moving in both directions from the PHY chip to the PHY chip. Why is that? Why the power is not going over the transformer? The reason is the capacitor C3 here, with the middle pin opened and the C3 capacitor. This capacitor is blocking the power, is blocking the current, so that it's not moving to the transformer. And this is a very interesting thing, because with this trick we not need to increase the wire thickness or the core material of the transformer. Instead, we can use the same transformer for power over data line like we use for the normal signals. Yeah, it's a very tiny part. Also here, the picture shows a capacitor C3, but in this case we really would recommend that you split the capacitor and put a capacitor each one at every lane, so that you have a capacitor C3 and C4 and C5. And we also would recommend that this capacitor has a capacitance of 470 nanofarad and 100 volt of isolation. Why 100 volt of isolation? The reason is that if we use the capacitor, then we will have, and we use power over data line, then we will have a path, some potential difference from the power lines to the ground here. And if we have a 48 volt system, then on every line, so this is plus minus 24 volt, this means that there is some kind of bias on the capacitor. In case of 48 volt, it's 24 volts, so it's half. And this means that the capacitance of the capacitor will be reduced. And here we did some measurement. In our case, the capacitance of the capacitor is reduced on 16%. So this is the schematic again of the power over data line. Interesting is also the filters that we need. This is U3 and U4. This is for filtering the power signal. And what is interesting here, so what we need is quite a high inductance, but we also need a high rated current for the high, yeah, so the current is also high, so the components get large, like we see here. Yeah, so on the right side, this is the single pair Ethernet filtered connector, the connector. On the left side, this is now with the transformer, the signal filtering. And this big thing here, this is one of the inductors. In this case, it's a coupled inductor. So here we use this coupled inductor U3 for the signals, and because of the high inductance and because of the high rated current of 1.5 amperes that we did, the component gets quite large. Of course, if you not need to supply a device with such a high current, this filter choke can be smaller. But of course, if the current is higher, then it's getting larger. Yeah, so this is quite a big component. It's not so big. Yeah, it's maybe 1.5 centimeters in square. But anyhow, it's a quite dominant component here. And this is the measurement that we did, sorry, for power over data line. And this shows here the limits again of the IEEE for the return loss. And in black, the measurements for return loss. And in red here, this is the mode conversion loss. Also here, the measurements. And in blue, but this is not a requirement of the IEEE, this is the CAM mode rejection. Also, CAM mode rejection is an important parameter, so we measured it. Here, the signal should be under minus 30 dB over the complete frequency range, and this is what the filter is doing, so it's working quite well. This is what we have for 100 base T1. So before I showed you 10 base T1, now 100 base T1. Now with another rated current. So this was some measurement that we did for a customer, and the customer, he needed something above 1 amperes of current. And so we searched another filter choke and used a bit of smaller one with 1.1 amperes of rated current. And this is the result of it. Yeah, also here, the measurements were good. This was not a measurement. This was a simulation that we ran. So from the return loss, everything was nice. From the mode conversion loss in the deep frequencies, there was we could not really exactly say if we reached the limit of the IEEE or not. But later on, we did some measurements, and the measurement were fine. The reason why the signal is going up and down here is that we do our simulations based on measurements. So we measure our parts and then put the parts together into simulations. Then there was some interesting case I'd like to show you. And this is power over data line for explosion protection. I don't know if explosion protection is the right English word here, but I think you know what I mean. So for cases of single pair Ethernet, some devices need to be in areas where you need to have protection against the explosion. And therefore, a normal transformer and also a capacitor is not sufficient for this, because the primary and secondary side of the signal is very close together, and this is not working. So we needed another solution, and the customer was asking us if we have a solution for that. And what we did here, this is also from simulation with SPICE, is that we used the CAM mode choke. We use the CAM mode choke as a transformer. So here we only have 4 pins. This means this CAM mode choke, this has not a middle pin, which is of course not that good for mode conversions, but we tried it. And the special thing on the CAM mode choke is that the winding was not bifilar winding. So the windings are not, it's not winding on winding. Instead, we have a sectional winding. So where there is some distance between the primary and secondary winding. And this is, here, this is where the CAM mode choke is used as a transformer. And this is the CAM mode choke that we were using. You can see here the winding, this is sectional. So it's not winding over winding. It's a toroid cord. And you see that the device, the transformer here is getting quite large, 14.5 millimeter and 9.5 millimeter in height. This is not less. But we needed a solution, and it should work. Yeah, so we tried to do that, and this is what we figured out. So we did a measurement on that, and the red line here, this is a simulation, what we simulated, and the black line here, this is what we measured. And we can see that with this solution for the return loss, we really hit the limits of the IEEE. So this actually could be a solution to have a large CAM mode choke instead of a transformer. Yeah, there was one guy from another company told me, be carefully with these solutions, because there is some APL working group, and they work on different solutions. Not that you recommend solutions for customers, and the norm says something different later. Yeah, this is true. On the other hand, we know about that different companies working on exactly this thing, that they replace the transformer with a car mode choke for the explosion protection. And of course that we fulfill, or that we have a complete picture, also the mode conversion loss. This is the measurement in black here. Also here we have quite good results. We are under the -45 dB that we need to reach, so everything is good here. So that's more or less it from my presentation here. If you need to have more information about single pair Ethernet, you can have a look at our landing page for single pair Ethernet. This is www.we-online.com-SPE. There you can find other webinars, a video, and more information. Also about the single pair Ethernet partner network, where we are a member of. Then we have an application node. This application node, it's still not online, but we try to bring it online soon. So I hope to make this in a couple of days. If not, you also can just shoot me an email. Then I can at least give you a good draft of the single pair Ethernet app node. Yeah, just have a look. Yeah, that's it from my side. Many thanks for everybody that watched the webinar. If you have questions on that, I'm quite happy to respond on that. Thank you. If there is no question so far, then maybe I reply one thing. And this is, maybe you missed the gigabit Ethernet. Yeah, so I showed you the 10 base T1, I showed you the 100 base T1, but I didn't show you the 1000 base T1. The reason for that is that the requirements out of the IEEE are even more challenging with the gigabit than for the 100 base T1. The requirements are so challenging that there's at the moment no solution on the market that we know. So no matter if we take a capacitor as isolation or if we take a transformer as isolation, we cannot reach the limits out of the IEEE. Yeah, this is a bit disappointing here, but we try to improve that. Yeah, we try to improve our components or the filter to have a solution on hand. Different IC houses, they know that fact. And from our communication with them, they said, okay, we know that there's no solution on the market for the filtering, so don't worry about that. Your solution with the transformer is good enough, so we take that. Yeah. But we take challenges and we try to improve ourselves also, so that we can also reach the gigabit single pair Ethernet. There's a question. Is there any advantage of transformer solution over simple capacitor in automotive application? Yeah, so the advantage I see clearly, this is with the transformer, this is the performance for 10 base T1. So the return loss is much better in deep frequencies with the transformer solution than the capacitor solution. And another advantage, of course, is the isolation. With the capacitor solution, the simple capacitor solution, you only have 50 volts of isolation. And this is working in the automotive. It's also working at some applications in the industry. Like if you have, for example, a camera and the user is never touching it or something. But normally you should have a transformer solution or something with 2 kV of isolation. This is just a IEEE and IC requirement. Then there's a question about the cable length. What is the reach of Ethernet? I said this quite at the beginning of the presentation. So the normal Ethernet, with the normal Ethernet, you can transfer data over 100 meters. And with single pair Ethernet, with 10 base T1, you can transfer data over 1 kilometer, or I have seen a data sheet of Texas Instruments where they say even 1.6 kilometers is the cable length that you can reach with single pair Ethernet. So this is quite a lot. Then there's a question, hi, why in power over data line applications as a filtering component couple coils were used instead of some standard high current common mode chokes? Yes, you can use high current common mode chokes. This is also what we did. But you need to connect them as not as a common mode choke. Instead, you need to connect them as a differential mode choke. This means that you not go in parallel inside with your connection. So this is like you have two single filters, but it's right, you can also use a combo choke as a filter. This is working. There's a question, I joined later, so not sure if you covered, but is there a power over Ethernet protocol? I think you mean power over data line protocol. Yes, there is. The protocol of power over data line is different to power over Ethernet. So you cannot use PSE or PD controller of power over Ethernet for power over data line. So the chip companies, they have to create new chips for that, and this is ongoing right now. So as far as I know, there is no PSE or PD controller on the market right now, but I think soon the first ones will come on the market with that. Yeah, so in a short time also there will be solutions for power over data line for the users on the market. All right. I have no other questions. Then many thanks to you. If you have other questions, then just let me know. Just write me an email, and I'll try to respond this as soon as possible. Many thanks for watching. Also, many thanks for Amelia for organizing all these webinars. It was a pleasure to be part of that. And maybe we will see us in another webinar. Have a nice day. Goodbye.